Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Concordia Digital Edition. In this tutorial, I will teach you everything you will ever need to know to play a full game of Concordia. Concordia is a turn-based engine-building game in which each turn you play one card. And that's it. Cards represent actions. When a card has two actions, you will have to choose one. Every player starts with the same hand of cards, but they can purchase more as the game progresses. To win the game, you have to have the most points at the end. Points, in short, come from cards. Each card is associated to a deity. Different deities award you points at the end of the game for different things. You can see which one does what from the rulebook, and you can see how many of each deity you have from My Points panel. It's in the top left corner. Let's have a look. For example, Vesta will give you 1 victory point for each 10 sesterces being gold. Jupiter will give you 1 victory point for each of your houses in a city that does not produce bricks, etc, etc. More than one of the same deity will stack in terms of how many points they give you at the end of the game, which is the basic idea behind building a strategy in Concordia. Now, if we have a look in my starting hand, and that is every player's starting hand, every time, every game, I have 1 Vesta card, 2 Jupiter cards, 2 Saturnus cards, 1 Mercurius card, and 1 Mars card. They give me a total of 7 points at the beginning of the game when I haven't done anything yet. If you hover over or click on the deity in My Points panel, the game will tell you exactly what the deity awards you points for. Okay, that's well and good, but how do you actually play the game? As mentioned previously, every turn you will play one card. Every player will play one card every turn, and that's about it. Cards equal actions. If you select a card, it will tell you exactly what the card does, or rather what its action does. For example, if I select Architect, it will tell me that move your colonists, you have 1 movement point for each colonist placed on the board. Then you can build cities adjacent to your colonists. This touches up on a very important point. So if we play the Architect here, we can move 1 of our colonists for up to 2 spaces, or both of our colonists, 1 space each. This is because we have 2 colonists on the board, everybody does at the beginning of the game, and each of those colonists gives us 1 movement point. We can use those movement points as we see fit and divide them between our colonists as we see fit. And now, if I select to move my land colonists from Roma to between Novaria and Aquileia, this will take 2 movement points, and that would be as far as I can move my colonists. Note that colonists will always end their move between cities, not inside them. Colonists only ever start in a city. It's called starting city in both starting maps, it's gonna be Roma. But after that, they will always be between 2 cities. And now that I have moved my colonists, I can construct a house in each of the cities adjacent to my colonists, provided I can afford the cost. The cost of constructing a house in a city is shown beneath the city name, and you can only ever construct 1 house in 1 city. So, the cost of constructing a house in Novaria would be 1 brick, 1 wine and 4 sesterces, while constructing a house in Aquileia would be 1 brick, 1 set of tools and 3 sesterces. As things are now, I can only afford 1 of them. The cost of constructing a city in trading goods will always remain the same throughout the game. However, the cost in sesterces being basically money, will increase based on how many houses already are constructed in 1 city. So, the next player that will want to build a house in Aquileia, like I did, they will have to pay double the money of the initial cost. So, for them it would be 6 sesterces. The third player will have to play 9, etc, etc. Yes, as you can see, the green player built their house in Novaria, so now, if I were to build a house there, the cost in goods would be the same, but I would have to pay 8 sesterces instead of 4. But what even is the point of building houses in cities? Well, first of all, those would count towards points from deities, that's what we mentioned previously. But also, let's take a look at the prefect card. This is the only card that we start with 2 of at the very beginning, and everybody does. The prefect lets us produce in 1 of the active provinces. Now what does that mean? When we play the prefect, we can see all of the active provinces on the map. So far, so good. Every province on the map is active because nobody before us played a prefect. We can choose any province, regardless of whether or not we have a house in there or not. But let's choose Italia, because that's where we have our house. If we select Italia, a number of things will happen. First of all, every player with a house in a city in that province, so in this case me with a house in Aquileia and green player with their houses in Novaria and in Syracuse, will receive a trading good based on the symbol of the city. So for me it would be 1 tools, for the green player it would be 1 wine and 1 brick. Those symbols, by the way, are randomized between games, so different cities will have different goods every game. In addition, me, as a player who played the prefect card and activated the province, would receive a bonus good based on the bonus good token, or banner, that we can see here. It's the thing on the little flag. So Italia would give me additional wine, Germania would give me cloth, etc, etc. If I were to be a Prefectus Magnus, which you can see by the Prefectus Magnus token here in the player's panel, in this case the red player is the Prefectus Magnus, I would receive the double bonus good from the bonus token. And then the Prefectus Magnus token goes to the player before me in the player order, and so on and so forth. The token will cycle between the player throughout the game. Now, the players will only receive the goods if they can fit them in their storehouse. You can see your storehouse space in the bottom of the screen. If you don't have enough storage space for all the goods that you're about to receive, you will have to choose which ones to receive and which ones will go to waste. If you don't have any space, you will not receive any goods whatsoever. Now that I have played the Prefectus card, I got my trading goods, the purple player got their trading goods, and the province is now inactive. We can see it here at the bottom of the province summary panel. Inactive provinces cannot be activated via prefect until somebody reactivates them. The way you reactivate provinces is the second option from the prefect card, where you reactivate every single province on the map, and you receive sesterce, so again money, based on how many and what kinds of provinces those were. Right now it's unlikely that anybody does that, because they all they would receive would be 2 sesterce from the 1 inactive province. Next up we have a senator. Senator's action allows us to purchase up to 2, but it can be 1, personality cards from the card display that can be accessed from the top right corner. From the card display we can see what the card does, and there are other cards, not just the copies of the starting hand, there are more cards in the game, and also the deity they are assigned to. So for example, in here we can see that the Mason is assigned to Minerva, which will give you 3 victory points for each city that produces a brick, and the Mason itself produces bricks in all your cities that produce bricks. The cost of the card will also change based on where it is on the card display. So the cost is divided into 2 parts. First of all, there's the cost on the card itself. This will not change. So the Mason card will cost 1 food. But also, as you can see, there is cost based on the slot of the card in the card display. And it will go higher and higher the more right the card is. Once we have purchased any cards, the remaining cards will slide to the left and new cards will be drawn to fill up the space. Once there are no more cards on the card display, the end game triggers. This is one of the 2 ways to trigger the end of the game. Next, we get to the diplomat. Diplomat will simply allow us to copy another card that another player played in the last turn.
You can copy all the cards except for another diplomat or a tribune.
You can see which cards were played last turn by the symbol next to the player's name in the player's panel, or by playing the diplomat and seeing the full cards with their descriptions. Then we have the Mercator. The Mercator allows you to make up to 2 transactions. A transaction is selling or buying any number of goods, provided you can afford the cost. So I could buy any number of any of the good that I have here, assuming I have sisters you to pay for it, or I can sell between one and all of the goods that I have. I do not have to make both of those transactions, but it's usually a good thing to do.
The mercator will also give you a few sesterces just to start things off, but the amount will change based on whether it's your starting hand mercator or one that you bought from the card display. And finally we get to the tribune, the last of the starting cards. The tribune is the way that you regain all of your discarded cards, discarded ones being the ones you have already played. In addition, the tribune will award you one sesterces for each card that you have just regained, in excess of three, meaning that the first three don't count for anything, but every card after that will award you one sesterces. You can always see all of your discarded cards by pressing this button over here. This will look a bit differently on mobile devices with smaller screens, but the functionality is the same. So, in this case, I would regain five cards. You can see the four are grayed out here, plus the prefect hidden behind my unplayed prefect yet, because the same cards do stack, plus the tribune I am just playing, giving me a total of three sesterces. In addition, when you play the tribune, you get the opportunity to recruit colonists in the starting city, assuming of course you can pay the cost and you have the colonists to recruit. By using the senator card from the card display, you will be able to purchase a colonist card that lets you recruit colonists in any city with your house in it, but the base tribune only allows you to recruit them in the starting city. Also, with the tribune you can only recruit one colonist, and with the colonist card you can recruit as many as you can afford to. Recruiting colonists is important for a number of different reasons. First of all, it increases the amount of options you have throughout the game. Secondly, if you have Mars cards, Mars counts victory points based on the amount of colonists you have on the board. And lastly, your unrecruited colonists, which you can see at the bottom there, they occupy space in your storehouse. So, once you have recruited them, you have more space for goods in your storehouse. And throughout the game you will learn that this space is actually very useful. And lastly, the more colonists you have on the board, the more movement points you have, and the further your colonists can go. This increases your options significantly throughout the game.
Now let's have a look at the players panel. In the players panel we can see, well, the player's name and symbol. We can see whether or not they are an AI or a human player, and if they are an AI, what difficulty AI they are. So we have easy, medium and hard. We can see how many houses they have built out of the maximum. The maximum is 15. This is the other endgame condition. Once one player has constructed their last house, the endgame triggers.
We can see how many cards they have in their hand versus the total number of their cards.
We can see their sesterces, their movement points, their goods, and in short, the number of slots they have in their storehouse. And lastly, depending on your game setup, you can see the player's victory points right here.
And just as a reminder, this is the Prefectus Magnus icon, meaning that the player who holds it will get the double bonus good from the province bonus token if they activate it via the prefect action. Now, speaking of game setup, let's take a look at game modules. So let's go all the way back to the game creation. As you can see, so far we have only three options, but this will grow as the expansions are being released. Basically everything that is being added to the game, mechanically speaking, will be treated as a module, so you can mix and match them as you want. Now, for the time being we have only three options, only one of which is actually truly a mechanical change, the other two are just... they are results of game design and are a reflection of the home rules that people would use. We can choose whether or not we can see the points being calculated live. The way it usually works in the base game of Concordia, as in the tabletop version, all of the victory points are being calculated as the last step of the game after the game has finished, so we can all see you know, at the very end who won or who lost. However, good players could very easily, in fact, calculate their own points as they go along, and they could also even calculate their opponent's points. This would take a significant amount of brain power, and I respect everybody who can
who is able to do so, but it can be done. We are giving you, the players, the options how you want to play the game. Whether you want to see the points of your opponents being calculated all the time or not. The other thing we can do is select whether or not we can see the opponent's cards all the time. You can see, you can spy on your opponent's cards if you have this option turned on in here by using this button. And the reason for this being an option is that the game rules actually never specify at all whether or not the cards that players have are open information or not. And given that every player's starting hand is identical, and you can see which cards player buys from the card display, you could very well remember or, you know, write down which cards they have and not have, and then track which cards they played and which cards they didn't. Now, this is controversial because this would also take a lot of brain power to keep track of. But given that the game never ever says whether or not your cards are hidden or not, here's the option. You can choose. And lastly, and this is an actual mechanical change, and it's absolutely official from the tabletop game as well, instead of getting a set of starting goods and some sesterce, every player can start with a lot of sesterce and no goods at all, and before their first turn, they get to purchase which goods they wish to. So, now that we are approaching the end of this tutorial, you now know how to play the game, how to play your cards, what do they do, and how to find out more details about what they do. You know how to score points and, in theory, how to craft your strategy towards winning. And, just a reminder, you also know how the game ends. The game ends when one of the players either constructed their 15th house, or there are no more cards in the card display available for purchase. The player who triggered this endgame receives a special Concordia card, which effectively is additional 7 points at the end of the game. Once the endgame is triggered, all the remaining players play their last turn and the game ends. And finally, let's take a look at different map views. Firstly, let's have a look at the top left. You can select the color palette of the map and whether or not you want to see the house building costs in the city. But also in the options menu, you can select whether you want to play with the 3D version of the map. This is the one we've played most of this tutorial with, or the 2D top-down view map. All of those options were introduced based on the player feedback we have accrued throughout the game's creation and post-launch. Whew, that would be that. That was a long but hopefully a helpful video for you. Don't forget to join us on Facebook if you're Facebook inclined, or on our Discord server. All the links will be in the description. Don't forget to subscribe to our newsletter in order to get notified of any and all news we may have to convey you. And also, share the thoughts about the game, whether it's on Facebook, Twitter, in the comments here, on Discord. We invite you to join us whenever. We are known to organize community-driven online tournaments of our games. We try to get an actual physical rewards, both from the board game publishers and also the digital codes for our games. All of those events are always free. We hope you have a lovely time with Concordia Digital Edition and any or all of our other digital board games. And until next time, thank you for staying with us and take care.